Welcome to School Talk. I'm Nadja Varney, your host. In our culture of immediacy, with instant messaging, quick global access, and online learning, I wonder sometimes, how did we get here, and where are we going? Well, I think history can educate us. Beyond dates and names of the wars and famous leaders, the social and cultural context of a nation affects every aspect of life. So today, I'm so delighted and honored to welcome to the set of School Talk here at George Mason University my guest, Dr. Peter Stearns, the provost of George Mason University. He brings a wealth of experience in research, teaching, and writing of history and social history. Dr. Stearns previously taught at a number of universities, was dean of Carnegie Mellon's College of Human and Social Sciences, past vice president of the American Historical Association in charge of the teaching division, and Dr. Stearns founded and serves as editor-in-chief of the Journal of Social History. He is actually the author and editor of over 85 books. So I am indeed honored to welcome you, Dr. Peter Stearns.
Thank you so very much.
Well, with all of the extensive writing and activities that you've been involved in, I wonder where this all began. How did you become interested in history, but especially and specifically social history?
Fair enough. Well, the history interest, I have to confess, my father did history. So I didn't intend to do history when I went to college because you don't want to do what your father does. But I loved the history courses I had there. And I think it was because they, to my mind, helped you explore the nature of what people are all about. And particularly, looking at situations in the past, you get a sense of how different people can be in different circumstances. Now, at present, I would say, what really turns me on is a little bit more systematic than that, and that's the way you can understand how people move from different settings in the past to the situations we're now in, so that you see how past shapes present. That wasn't what turned me on initially, but that's what's helped keep me going. Social history, I latched on to really in graduate school. It was fairly new as a focused interest in the United States at that point, and the opportunity to explore what ordinary people have done and what certain topics are that aren't the conventional political and great ideas kinds of topics, those continue to intrigue me. So that's what brought me to the social part.
Yes, in fact, I think just before we came on the set, I read where you were giving speeches at Harvard School of Health and other places on social issues like addictions and so forth. So it's intriguing to me that a historian with your huge background, that you're so interested in that. It sounds so wonderful. And I wonder if you could characterize for me, for the average Joe, for the average person, why is it so important? I see your perspective of looking at how patterns happen, people and places changing, but for the average person, why should they be interested in social, studying social and cultural history? And also, has it increased? Do you think the interest has increased? I mean, right now we have novels by David McCullough and Doris Kearns Goodwin and Peter Beshaw's others. We have a lot of that kind of writing now, which I don't remember having some years ago. So my question is, how would you characterize the importance for just the average person who doesn't really want to study it as you presented it? And has that interest increased or diminished in recent times?
Okay. First part of the question. Mm-hmm. I think the subject of social and cultural history can be of wide interest for a couple of reasons. First of all, because it's talking about the wide pattern of what life is all about, not just voting, but also emotions and family behaviors and that sort of thing, you get a sense, again, of the range of human experience. And it's simply interesting to find out how different things were, sometimes really a surprisingly short time ago. So I think there's an item simply of interest there, particularly when it attaches to relatively ordinary people and ordinary situations in life. And then the plug I would add to that, as I've already suggested, is then the next step is, how did we get from then to now? And how does that help us understand now? So my basic argument is, as you suggested at the outset, history is interesting in itself for many people, but I think it's of particular interest because it explains how we got to where we are now and maybe a little bit where we're likely to go next. Mm-hmm. As to the level of interest, the kind of history that actually grabs most Americans is the history of their own family, which is candidly understandable but also fairly narrow. I can't claim that this leads inevitably to social history, but it does connect to the subject of social history, because history of the family is one of our big topics. I think the interest was greater 15 years ago than it is now. Museum interest in social history was very high in the 80s and early 90s. I think maybe it's dropped off a little bit, but the link to things like family interests still, I think, is quite vivid.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting to me, because I just read an article, I think it was in a popular magazine, Newsweek or somewhere, where trying to find one's chronology, you know, in family history is becoming so much more difficult because we have many more adoptions, we have interracial and ethnic groups mixing, children coming from other countries, as well as just a whole new social pattern. So when you mentioned the family history, that's quite interesting, although I think that's probably where most of us start to be interested.
For many people, yeah. Mm-hmm. And obviously one of the things I'd like to do is figure out a better way to help people continue to be interested in their family history, but also have a slightly greater sense of the history of the family to which their situation could link. Either to say, gee, we were very different from general patterns, or, oh, that's interesting because it illustrates this particular type of change.
Yes. It's amazing how my mind is ticking back to, I have a very unusual mixture for a background, and my mother's people, looking at me, you won't believe this, but are Swedish and Norwegian.
Okay.
That's, the coloring is from my father's side. But it was interesting because one of my brothers, we were reading about it and learned that he was very much like a great-great-grandfather who lived in a totally different culture, but his actions, he loved the children and would take them in his wagon with his horses, which was much like my brother in the current day. So
very good.
I really had thought about social history in that way, but now I better get back to the topic that I'm here to interview you
Fair
about.
Enough.
And one of the things that has changed, that have changed, are the expectations on leaders and the way we look at our leaders, and especially I'm concerned about teachers. So, you know, we had the sage on the stage, and then we had the guide on the side, and all kinds of patterns in teaching, expectations of us, and I say us because I am a retired teacher. So how have the emotional and social expectations for teachers changed in maybe this last century?
Well, I mean, first of all, it's only in the last century that school got serious for most people anyway.
True.
So
that's right.
The situation of teachers has changed greatly, and I think the demands have in many ways clearly increased. In the first place, although we don't often recognize it, we actually expect kids to know a good bit more out of school than we expected 50 years ago. That's not too commonly realized, but because we worry about how much they don't know, fair enough.
But
we expect a lot more achievement in math and even in subjects like history than was the case 50 years ago. Then we do assume that teachers are going to have some responsibility for the less cognitive aspect of children's development, so they're supposed to pay some attention to emotional control and that sort of thing. They're supposed to be reasonably careful in dealing with children's emotions, and I think those demands, they're perfectly reasonable, but those demands aren't are considerable. It's obviously, to take a specific example, much less feasible to get angry at a child in class successfully than was the case 50 years ago. You're just not supposed to do it. Well, fair enough, it's a reasonable expectation, but it is an additional demand. So we expect informal as well as formal school lesson type achievements from teachers, and it's a fairly demanding package, and it's not surprising that we often feel that teachers don't entirely measure up.
Because of the high expectations.
Yeah, because of the high expectations,
exactly. Yes.
We're a funny culture. We expect a tremendous amount from schools in terms of learning achievement, social development, activities, and yet we aren't really very confident that schools are doing their job. So the expectations mix in very curious ways. Makes it hard to be a teacher.
Yes, and in fact, where do the parents stand in this? When you said a teacher can't get angry or anything, you know, show emotion, well, I think there are ways when you do feel anger how to deal with that, because you'd be a robot if you weren't angry with some of the things that happen in public schools today. But I think I understand what you mean, that we have to have a way to deal with it. There's no more spanking children
or dunce cap in
dunce
the corner, that sort of thing.
Sitting in
exactly
the corner.
So.
I'm just laughing. I think once I was a little too late and I had to do something like that in New York City. So things have changed. But where do the parents fit in? You know, teachers, children come to school, and you know, in some poverty areas, they've never had books. They have had few toys. And what's the problem? I mean, how do we deal with that problem with children entering school? We expect them to know more than what we expected them to know years ago. Kindergarten teachers, I mean, first grade teachers today are teaching what second grade teachers taught years ago.
Exactly, right.
So where does that begin? Doesn't it begin in the home?
Well, ideally, sure. And we obviously have an issue because, as you already suggested, homes vary and simple financial resources vary greatly. And every indication is some of these inequalities have increased in our society over the past 20 years. So you are dealing with a real set of issues in terms of trying to create a level playing field, and we don't manage to do it as well as we would like.
Mm-hmm. Earlier today, I think I mentioned, I talked with Dr. Shram, who's very interested in technology in education. So I'm thinking in this global digital information age right now, we have new things to think about besides just behavior and learning the basics in a curriculum. Issues around intellectual property and patent laws and new ways to find information, which leads to my question, all of these do, around values. Because with Google access, I think students are often confused. Why can't I just, you know, copy and paste and
sure.
put this in here? When is it plagiarism? And when is it honest? When is it dishonest? So I guess I'm wondering, are the values around the issues of plagiarism, cheating, and just learning, have those values changed, or is there confusion today about it?
Well, there's certainly some confusion. I wish I could give you a really dramatic answer, because it's a historical topic. You're asking, has there been change? And I'm an historian, and that's what I deal with. I honestly don't know. You have to remember that copying from encyclopedias was available a while back and still happens. It's just now that they're more likely to be on the internet than in conventional text. There were places that would write essays for college students for pay 50 years ago. Well, they do it differently now, but they're still available. I don't personally sense a massive deterioration in students' morals and values. Opportunities have changed. And I also think we're actually in some ways more vigilant than we used to, because remember, the technology allows you to catch people much more clearly than was the case 50 years ago. I end up being agnostic. We have problems. They're clearly not new problems. I'm not sure it's gotten a lot worse.
Well, thank you. That gives me a little hope, because, you know, in the popular culture, you usually hear all the negatives about what
right.
students are doing and when they cheat or when they do something wrong. So thank you. That gives me a little optimism.
One other thing to note is American students are actually, on the whole, less likely to cheat than students in some other cultures, which is perhaps another encouraging thing.
Yes, and I can understand why. And, well, I won't editorialize, but when we compare test scores around the world, it upsets me very much because, as you well know, in Asian countries, many of the students who are tested are only the very brightest who get into universities. And here, you can come off the boat from somewhere and say, go and try the test anyway, see if you can make it. We measure everybody and come out with an average. So I think our students are pretty wonderful, too, and not cheating anymore, and probably less than others. But we need to take a break right now. But we know we're in a whole new world, so I have some very interesting, to me anyway, questions about the whole global marketing and consumerism and how this all ties to what happens in education. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Oh, my.
Dr. Stearns, we mentioned a little bit about the parents earlier, but I feel that families and the whole social culture of family, mothers, fathers, parents have such a strong influence. I wondered if you'd speak about how parental involvement is now helping or leading students in their choices in education in recent years. I think there's some changes that are going on.
Sure. Well, the first thing to say is there is, of course, no parent. There are all sorts of parents.
That's true.
And I think the average level of parental involvement in school has probably gone down, most obviously because of women's new work commitments over the past several decades. But in the last two decades, there has definitely been a phenomenon of growing parental effort to be involved with their kids' upbringing, to sponsor all sorts of activities, and if not to join school organizations, at least to pay a lot of attention to what teachers are doing to help their kids to be on top of things, sometimes, frankly, to do their kids' work for them because they want it done right.
And, you know, sometimes that the blame belongs to the teacher, because teachers in the lower grades can tell when the parent's doing it. And they're often, those children who get the parental help are often rewarded. I've seen this happen.
Sure.
And the child who doesn't have that parent's help, who may be out doing nursing in the evening or whatever, that child's work may not be as good. So there are new problems, for even for the teacher, in evaluating work, because parents jump in and do much of
that's
the work.
That's right. And I think many teachers are finding also that not every parent, but a significant handful of parents, is not only jumping in to help with the work, but really getting on top of teachers if they don't think little Johnny is getting the kinds of grades that little Johnny deserves. And I think most teachers report that this is a really significantly increasing problem over the last two decades, from grade school right really on into college. Mm-hmm. We get it to the college level also.
Mm-hmm. And I think actually that leads into something else I have on my mind here, which relates to the expansion of our global markets, growing consumerism everywhere, and the global competition, which I think may be driving some of what you're talking about. There are new reasons and new pressures on people as to why they want to go to college. I remember just, you know, you should go to college and be a well-rounded person and learn, enjoy learning. But I wonder now what you think. What major cultural factors are influencing students, their motivation, their choices for higher ed? What do you think?
Well, it's obviously a mixture. Depends a bit on the student, but clearly, there's at this point just a sense of social expectation. Almost every 70% of our population at the appropriate age goes off to college, and so for many people, there's not that much choice involved. There is certainly the belief, and it's an accurate belief, that college is going to help you in the work world and in terms of earning power. So that's a powerful driver. I would like to think that there's a certain level for some students of actual intellectual inquiry, that the notion that you're going off partly to improve your life capacity, not just your work capacity. I think that's present with some children, mm-hmm. with some students, a real curiosity that helps keep them going. It's a mixture of motives.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm glad to hear you say that, because again, from what you read in the popular press and what you hear more often is to make good money. And in fact, you see the lineup of people going into law because of this litigious culture that
sure.
we live in, and because of how teachers aren't really respected as much as I think they should be, or remunerated, we don't see the line as long at the registration table to become teachers, especially among men.
Yeah, but I mean, yes, you're right, clearly, and there are issues here that are serious social issues. But you also want to remember this generation of college students, although it has some real faults, is very high on the volunteer side, very high on the altruism side. So there are some real strengths here mm-hmm. that, among other things, push some of them, at least for a while and sometimes lifelong, into careers like teaching. They're not just out for the buck. Mm-hmm. Collectively.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's probably the best way to look at it, non-collectively, because sometimes what seems to be the majority isn't always so in our culture.
Right.
Well, speaking now on the other end of the spectrum, there are those who are going on to college and do well and have good motivation and interest, and then there are some who end in terrible tragedies as at Virginia Tech. And since that tragedy and since 9/11, people say we're living in this culture of fear. And there was an article, actually, in Chronicle of Higher Ed, and I'm quoting, it says, "What happened at Virginia Tech will change higher education law significantly and permanently, much as the shootings at Kent State did nearly 40 years ago. But beyond, you might want to speak to the accountability of the university to the law, but I'm wondering about the cultural thing here about fear. Do you think fear has significantly affected the college campus?"
Okay, I would answer honestly, it has affected it, but probably not significantly, fortunately. Mm-hmm. I think after the Tech shooting, now I'm at an institution that's in Virginia, and
yes.
a lot of our students had friends at Tech, so the connection was close. There was obviously a lot of grief. Mm-hmm. I think there was a certain brief manifestation of fear, particularly showing up in the sense, please tell us that it can't happen here, which was an understandable but frankly silly impulse. Nobody can tell you that it can't happen
That's right.
here.
Mm.
So I think that cropped up, and it does reflect, I think, a measurable increase of fear in our culture over the past, even before 9/11. Is it overwhelming? No, fortunately. So most people balance it with a sense of at least a little bit of a sense of what risks are really terribly pressing and what are more remote. And I think most people keep this sort of thing in decent perspective. But yes, a little element, and it's the kind of thing that every time a new incident occurs, it builds it a little further. Remember, this goes all the way back to the shooting at the University of Texas in 1967, which did not occasion this kind of immediate national inquiry into what is every institution doing and how can they reassure us. So we've changed a bit, and some of the changes are prudent and some of them probably are a little bit suspect.
Even more than suspect, I just wonder how any institution, a large institution like George Mason University, can identify somebody who has social and psychological problems. They're not always overt. I mean, just in the news,
right,
a famous wrestler just did this terrible thing, killing his wife and himself. And this was a person that everyone thought was well-adjusted. So I don't know of the expectations, again, in this culture, on especially at the higher education level, are they realistic?
Well, I mean, there is a level of statement periodically that implies that we should be able to arrange things so there is no risk. And that bears on colleges, it bears on other institutions as well. And that can be pressed too far. And I have some concern about it because we can't remove every risk. We want to make sure that, among other things, we preserve the rights of students to be weird. That's one of the things that go with growing up.
Oh, thank goodness.
So you know, but I actually think most people, when except in the immediate aftermath of the media news about something like the Tech shootings, I think most people realize that you take some of this with a grain of salt, and you want reasonable measures, but you don't want people to pretend that there's no risk involved.
I think that makes a great deal of sense to me. And maybe now taking this to a wider view, I'm looking at the world and all of its complexities. We are now a global society,
right,
to some people's joy and to some people's chagrin in many ways. But also, we have more complexities within the universities and colleges with diversity and all kinds of complexities. And so I'm asking you a wider question here and wondering, how do you see higher education affecting positive change? Of course, wondering what one might mean by positive change. But in your opinion, you're a historian, and how do you see higher education affecting real positive change in American culture?
Okay. We don't affect as much change as I would like to believe that we can or should. I mean, you have to be realistic. But I think on the whole, for example, evidence is that better educated people, at least in the American context, are somewhat more tolerant than people at large. And I find personally tolerance to be a really positive value, particularly in a global society. I would like to think that as higher education does more in the area of global education, we will go not from just tolerance to better knowledge about how other societies function and how we can relate to them knowledgeably as well as tolerantly. So I think we, higher education, not just in terms of individual career preparation, but in terms of orientation to a wider world, I think we make some difference. It's just not as great as I wish it were, to be honest.
Yes. Well, no, I appreciate that. And because I was speaking mainly about our own American culture, but what do you see as the major challenges to higher education and those who come from higher education in exerting a strong positive influence in the growing global society?
Well, I mean, there are obviously two answers. One is, I think a national education system, a national higher education system, has a responsibility to try to keep the skill levels of its citizens up in a whole range of areas, including obviously science and technology. And this is competitively essential. And we know this, and we hopefully can do better with this knowledge than we have in the recent past. Mm-hmm. Beyond that, I think that higher education also has a liberal responsibility, and that's liberal with a small L. It's not a partisan statement. In terms of encouraging a breadth of values, a breadth of mind, an ability to apply different techniques toward identifying and solving problems, this is where I think higher education, particularly in the American tradition, has a stake that goes beyond technical skill provision, and I think we can and should maintain this stake as well.
Mm-hmm. I'm glad you broadened that away from just the and you've said that several times, beyond just getting a job and, you know, a wider point of view. I think it was David Kerr who wrote Shakespeare, Einstein, in the bottom line, and being so frightened that our higher institutions of higher education are getting captured by the market force. And do you see you know, any kind of a challenge to higher education, especially now that we're getting global. And our country, it seems to me, money seems to be in short supply, public monies. So historically, again, here's a whole cultural change, I think, happening with the market moving into education. How do you see that happening? Is it positive, negative?
Well, first of all, it's not new. Education has always been a market-driven activity to some extent. The market has changed. As you say, it's become more globally competitive. We have a lot more people trying to use higher education for personal betterment, and that's a huge change in the past several decades. I think we need to be very careful to insist that market forces need to be reckoned with, but we are not a business in the sense of having absolutely market-driven motives and forces. We are preparing for a larger set of life circumstances, although this term doesn't get used as much as it used to. We're still trying to prepare people for productive citizenship as well as productive work lives. Those are market forces in a broad sense, but they're not narrow, and we need to make sure that the business analogy with higher education doesn't get pressed too far.
I like that. That sounds good. We have just about 40 seconds left, and you can choose, or maybe you can get both answers in. Your greatest concern or frustration with higher education's ability to influence and adapt in our social and cultural changes, or in recent years, what's been a major accomplishment in our cultural and social achievement affecting education that gives you optimism?
Well,
which would you like?
Let me try to deal a little bit with both of them by saying I think the one of the clearest challenges for us now in higher education is to maintain access at a point where it's very easy to cater to the students who have good preparation and whose families already have a substantial amount of money. We need to preserve this balance, and that's what I think our greatest challenge is.
Thank you very much. Very well said, caring about all Americans. Thank you, Dr. Stearns. And in closing, I'm going to quote from an article by, guess who? Dr. Peter Stearns. Why study history? Quote, history should be studied because it is essential to individuals and to society, and because it harbors beauty, end quote. As demonstrated throughout history, that is summarily insightful school talk.